This episode of Capes and Lunatics is brought to you by Tweaked Audio. Get awesome headphones, go to tweakedaudio.com and use the coupon code Southgate to get 30% off, free shipping, and a lifetime warranty. Or you can get there through the link on our website, southgatemediagroup.com.
This is Luca Perich, and you're listening to the Capes and Lunatics podcast.
There's a thin line between heroism and madness.
Here the line fades to nothing at all. This is a world of capes and lunatics.
And nothing is off limits.
It's been really great stealing your identity.
Who is that, Brian Crota?
That's the real Moz.
That's one of the Mozes, the one who gets in Charlie's house.
Whoa!
Going back to the Capes and Lunatics. I am Phil. Joining me, as always, the Stash from New Jersey. It is
Charlie, the Professor Esser.
And the Drunk from Florida. It is
A Drunk from Florida. I can't take that title. You almost fight me there with Hellfire. Also, it's Friday night, so why not?
Oh, you know what you could be?
It's a monster. Calm down.
Hell.
Guess someone's not sleeping tonight.
Hell. I was going to say, you could be the responsible drunk from Florida.
Yes.
You might be the other one of those.
There's so. Always a drunk responsible. That's all I know.
Stay thirsty, my friends. Anyway, so.
Another slow week.
Not for Joss Whedon.
Oh my goodness.
It's overdue. I mean, it was an open secret, but he's finally pissed off all the wrong people and they're pushing him out. And that's just how it goes. It's just
well,
how it
you
goes.
Know, I think we're just at a point where people are just sick of it all.
Abusive power, like, yeah.
Sick of pervert.
Yeah, you know? Like, you know what? F it. Yeah. Heck with him. You know, it's
but everybody's it's so, still like Ray Fisher, you can't work either though, so you know.
Well, you know, but that's also because Ray Fisher's
didn't go about it the
well,
right
when you're
way.
Making ultimatums to the head of Warner movies.
Yeah, I mean,
are you sure his mom's not managing him? Because that feels like a momager move. Like a Lindsay Lohan, you know, momager move. not to be confused with Chris Jenner momager.
I mean, I'm gonna be honest with you, he's you know, Ray Fisher is not wrong. Who's the guy who played Gunn? Has he weighed in on this yet?
J. August Richards.
Well,
yeah.
He got a job on S.H.I.E.L.D. for like a couple of episodes. I don't know.
Well, I believe, yeah, he weighed in. I believe today it was him, James Marsters. I didn't see what he said, but Anthony Head said something.
Which raised everybody's eyebrows.
Oh, yeah. Did you see the Michelle
Trachtenberg? So everybody's basically saying it's time to just tear off the band.
Oh, yeah. Did you see? They said they had a Michelle Trachtenberg role where they're like, yeah, Joss isn't allowed in a room alone with her. And she was 15 at the time when she was on that show.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, it's unfortunate that, you know, the guy couldn't handle handle the power, you know? Some people can't handle being in charge of things. They can't handle the idea that they never learned Patrick Swayze's lesson from Roadhouse, which is be polite.
Yes.
You go farther when you're polite. Which means that when someone comes to you and gives you news you're not happy about, you say,
You don't ask them, are they keeping it?
But yeah, that's
old tea, though. That is so old and well-known. Like,
what?
Oh, yeah, no, I know.
The Carpenter tea is so old that...
Yeah. Well, yeah, but that's the thing. It wasn't... You know, it's symptomatic. And that's the thing. I'm willing to wager... There's an aspect of it where, you know, it's one of these things where the person, because he's so used to not being polite, didn't realize that he was supposed to be polite. And that's the thing.
Well, that's also how Angel got fired. I mean, got canceled. So, you know, the signs were there. If you know the story, you know the story. But
yeah.
The signs were all there.
You know, but that's a thing.
It's just not that great that I'm going to ignore that.
Yeah. Well, you know, personally, I'm not even that. I've still yet to watch Firefly. I don't know if it's that good or not.
Trust me. I mean, it's really, you kind of lose the point when everybody's a Han Solo. Like, you lose the point of Han Solo if everybody's Han Solo.
Yeah.
Yeah, it saves you 13 episodes.
I don't know. I liked it when the people, this is what I always say, you know, I like John Waters because he keeps his skeletons in his living room.
Yes, he wears that freak flag proud and high. Yeah.
You know what you're getting with him. He's not trying to be anything else. He's like, you know, and Gene Roddenberry with those, you know, short skirts in Starfleet. You know, we knew who he was. He wasn't hiding who he was, and it didn't detract from the other things he could do. You know, and for what it's worth, Gene Roddenberry, notoriously a polite person. You know, so
it's the Navy training.
Yeah, you know, that's the thing. If you are polite, that's the thing. If you are polite, you can address your concerns, because here's the thing. I will be honest with you. An actress becoming pregnant in a series, that is a conundrum for the producer, that they now have to say, okay, how will we address this? Because do we write them out of the show? Do we have them hold a basket of fruit? Do we suddenly have lots of coats in her wardrobe?
Well, what but are we you going- have to think about the season before she even got pregnant. It was weird. So, like, let's not even start with the whole season before things were weird. So that's just a cherry on the poop sundae.
I mean, and that's the thing. But I'm using that as an example because that is the kind of thing where from a managerial point of view, it almost sounds reasonable to have that be a concern for a producer, but there are better ways that you handle it, which is how usually good producers handle it. They say, okay, well, you know, I think you're going to be holding a lot of fruit this season. Whoa. You know, we're going to have you stay.
Give them the old CC from the nanny.
You know, what if we did a weight gain episode, you know, which is... Just said you got really fat. Or let's just say.
I'm saying is Alice Hannigan on How I Met Your Mother, I think she had like two or three kids during the course of those 9 seasons, and they handled it perfectly.
So, well, exactly.
That's all that I'm saying.
Because it's not something you can't handle. You know, it's not something that you can't deal with unless your problem is someone, you know, having a life outside of your show. You know, and that's the thing. It's just like.
He's finally pissed off all the wrong people and everybody. This is just the typical trend where everybody just comes out of the world. I wouldn't be surprised to hear from his fourth grade teacher. He was a no good kid, I tell you. You know, that's just how it is. Well, I've just kind of been waiting on this one. I didn't know. Ray Fisher kind of pushed the snowball down the hill, and I'm just like, okay, it's not really picking up traction. Then he got let go of that TV show, and I'm like, okay.
Yeah. I don't know.
It's interesting. It's interesting, to say the least.
Yeah. You know, it is what it is.
He's not doing anything that a million other people aren't doing literally right now at this moment, okay? You know. So.
You know, of course, then you have the Gina Carano? Carano?
Carano, yeah.
Yeah, Gina Carano.
Yeah, they were trying to cancel her anyway, so I think they finally...
Well, yeah. Because, you know, she violated the contract that says don't say stupid things out loud. Everything you say, do, or breathe while you're on a Disney property, you run it through the lawyers.
Yes, they have a character clause.
They gave her a couple chances. Yeah. I think first there was
a lot of chances.
There was some
like
weird thing.
There
was like weird comments about transgender people, and then then she was one of the kooks. So you know the election was stolen. But I think the final
don't get me started on that one because it broke my heart. Like I was already on the border with Kevin Sorbo. Like I was like, okay, I love Hercules. I love all the other stuff you've done. Just shut the hell up.
Speaking of that fandom, did you see some of the fans were like, you know what, since we're canceling Gina Carano, we're like, what
Lucy Lawless, baby.
Yeah, they said, let's keep the character and just have Lucy Lawless portray the character from here on out.
I mean, it's fine by me. I like Lucy Lawless. She's cool. Just keep her off of horses. I don't want her to break her back again.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, just don't let her ride a horse. Just get her one of those nice CGI horses, a little pony, and she'll be fine.
I mean, the Mandalorian's mostly like the big CGI scape now.
Give her some stunt women, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And not for nothing.
Lucy Lawless, you know, she's a tall glass of woman. So it's a little, probably why a lot of women end up doing their own stunts. Either you're too small or you're too tall, things like that.
Yeah. Well, you know, that is the thing. But I'm all for Lucy Lawless. She hasn't done anything stupid yet that I know of. And that's the important thing. I don't care if you do things stupid. Just don't let me hear about it, you know?
Oh, yeah, not even stupid. I think, didn't Lucy Lawless tell Kevin Sorbo to shut up?
Yeah,
or something?
She's like, all right. Oh, yeah. unfollowed.
But that's the thing. It's like, you know...
It is what it is. Everybody's living their own reality. I mean, times are poop. I get it. But keep it to yourself, bro. You don't have to be on Twitter with it. You can keep it on Parler, Clubhouse. I don't need that on my Twitter feed.
The thing is that, you know, there are certain things that when you say it out loud, people say, oh, yeah, that's a nice thing for you to say. And then the people who don't like that thing being a nice thing to say get mad that they can't say that it's not nice. And it's like, well, no, because this person's saying, you know what, hey, everybody just be cool. Because you know what, you're a woman, you're a man, you're something in between. Fine by me, what do I care?
Honestly, it's like, is it really affecting you? Does it?
Exactly.
That's the thing. Well, the last thing for Gina Carano, I guess, is she compared, I don't know if she compared just herself or all Republicans in this country to Jews in Nazi Germany.
Jews in Nazi Germany.
Yeah, like,
yeah.
Whoa, everybody knows. Ooh. You. Everybody knows.
Yeah.
Nick Cannon learned that. We just got done dealing with that with Nick Cannon. Come on, people.
Well, you know, it just, yeah. Well, Nick Cannon's was a little bit different, but yeah, it is.
We're on the same lines.
I mean, yeah. Well, what it is, it's a claimed victimization, and this is, you know, I had a whole conversation the other day because, you know, someone was saying, oh yeah, man, you know, cancel culture, that's like the Nazis burning books. I'm like, no,
not at all, sir.
Exactly. Because the whole idea. Yeah,
they cry that they don't have freedom of speech, but it's like, yeah, you could say whatever you want, but
you just might get a twisted T upside your face. Those are the consequences.
That or your employer fires you, or, you know, something.
You can say what you want, but there's consequences.
Yeah. Well, but I love the fact that, you know, people that are, and there was a whole thing Brian Cronin had mentioned, and someone else did a nice display of it, of all of the people that were like, oh, what's this woman doing in Star Wars? and then they're like, how dare they fire Star Wars?
I don't think they actually got Star Wars or Star Trek for that matter, or maybe they were just too young and it's just all nostalgia, and that all the nuance, not even nuance in original Star Trek, all the politics and stuff that go with it.
Well, that's like those idiots who say superheroes are too woke now. It's like, have you not been paying attention?
Have you met Captain America? Like, yeah. That's been his thing forever?
Well, to be fair, 1940s Captain America was very, very racist against Japanese people.
I'm saying anything from the Stan Lee 60s to now. It's like, you have
anything from the 60s, ever since the 60s when comic book writers...
We didn't stop with the propaganda, but we lightened up on the propaganda.
they made different propaganda.
They made it a little nicer, easier to digest. Exceptionalism.
The 40s was a simpler time, but you still got, hey, let's punch Hitler in the face. I mean, Captain America's first appearance.
Well, of course. I mean...
We had a whole war about it, you know?
Yeah. But it is, it's unfortunate. And it's unfortunate when it's an artist you like. And I'll be honest with you, I liked a lot of the stuff Joss Whedon did. I love the Avengers.
I love Angel, when we were doing that podcast, I threw all the shade in the world. Like, well.
Yeah, but it's like, you know, I would rather, you know, and this gets to the death of the artist kind of concept and the idea that, you know, we have to just sort of, so, you know what, we can like artwork.
But the Harry Potter fandom has rejected J.K. Rowling's point blank.
Oh, yeah. But they still love Harry Potter.
Merchandise, the whole thing.
They still love Harry Potter.
We don't give her money. We make bootleg
merchandise. At this point, you don't actually even have to give her money because that's what fanfic's for. You know?
Exactly. We make our own merchandise.
Already read the books, man. You can't take that away from me. I've never read the books.
You wouldn't like it. It's a very millennial thing.
I would imagine. Well, you know what? I probably if I had read it when I was of that age, It would have been very.
Kids are reading. That's all that. Like big, thick, dusty books. That's all that mattered to me.
It's like me and the Chronicles of Narnia. I love the Chronicles of Narnia. And every time someone wants to like hate on the Chronicles of Narnia, I'm like, man, it's Christian propaganda. It's like I went to a Catholic school. What else was I going to read? It was a talking lion and a talking beaver. Okay.
Boy, yeah.
Give me some mugwumps. This is great stuff. You know. And that's the thing. Whatever you embrace in your youth, it's great. But then you have to say at some point, well, you know, maybe the guy who wrote it was, or the woman who wrote it, in J.K. Rowling's case, wasn't really the best role model. But you know what? I wasn't following them because they were a role model. I was following them because they wrote a good story. Exactly. And a good story is a good story regardless of what the writer who wrote it did.
And again,
honestly, in my elder years, like, it's not even that good of a story. It's just really a ripoff of a lot of that typical British, you know, away school stuff. So,
And again, a lot of times, especially back in the day, like when you come across a work, you don't even know who the author or who makes something is besides a name, and it's just like, oh, okay.
Well. Ooh, disclosure, if you ever see the rest of this office and you see Ayn Rand books, it's just research. Full disclosure.
Yeah. I'm just gonna throw this out here. You know what? I really have no idea what R.L. Stein's political persuasion is. And I don't think R.L. Stein wants to tell me that.
And you would never be able to from his writings is the point, too. I guess you're trying
to... Exactly. I mean, R.L. Stein, and he's still making new things, man. R.L. Stein is
still... That Goosebumps movie, don't sleep on it. It was okay.
No. Well, he is churning out. He's got a new thing coming out, too. I mean, he just wrote the Man Thing series. It was not as popular as people were hoping, but, you know...
It was something
he took a risk. He was like, I've never written comics before, but what the heck? You want to pay me some money to write a Man-Thing comic? That sounds like fun. I mean, let's go to Hollywood with Man-Thing.
That's supposedly one of the ways to be a good business person. It's like people aren't supposed to know what your personal beliefs are, you know, or whatever.
Oh, not anymore. People live and die by that whole thing now.
I guess.
Have you seen YouTube lately? I mean, a lot of people are getting scrubbed off of YouTube for it, but, you know. Have you seen YouTube lately?
Oh, yes.
But the thing is...
I saw a plucky young woman talking about the state of YouTube the other day, yes.
Gross and repetitive. No offense if you're watching on YouTube.
I don't know, man. I just watch videos about math and ancient history, so I don't know.
I'm just saying, except for MatPat. If MatPat ever becomes problematic, I will freaking cry. That's all that I know. Like, I'll have to stop watching Game Theorists, Field Theorists, and Food Theorists, which is the best channel.
See, I don't think MatPat's ever going to become problematic, because I don't think MatPat is that invested in social issues.
Exactly.
You know, that's the thing. That is the thing about social issues, is like, usually it comes down to this idea that this person wants to do this thing that makes them happy. And you go, okay, why am I mad that they want to be happy doing this thing? Not my cup of tea, you know, but okay. You know, I mean, if you want to have a big debate about it, you know, it's like, well, that's not a choice I would make. But I guess that's because that's not who I am, and that is a choice they would make. So,
I mean, look,
good for them.
I mean, 99% of the time, you don't know what Lil Hellfire's personal business is. She don't even use her real name, but you know what her thoughts on Spider-Man are.
I'm here for Peter.
I mean, come on.
Yes, well, you know, Spider-Man is not problematic. He's a decent enough guy, a little whiny, a little needy, let's be honest, has a lot of girlfriend issues.
Admissible evidence. It's legally admissible evidence.
Yes, it is. You know, but he's a nice guy. He loves his aunt. You know, he makes stupid decisions, but don't we all? Honestly, if we had the opportunity to become the world's greatest masked wrestler, wouldn't we all try to go 10 minutes with Hacksaw or
Crusher Hogan? You know. Yeah.
Crusher Hogan, thank you. I was trying to remember what the original name was. Crusher Hogan.
I'm here for Peter.
Yes. Actually, no, it was Bonesaw. Bonesaw in... Bonesaw! The great Randy Macho Man Savage. Some of his finest work. Spirit of the Macho Man. Another person. I have no idea what Macho Man Randy Savage's political persuasion is. I don't care, because he was a kid. Yeah, and that's where Hulk Hogan gets to be worrisome.
You mean besides being
a... It's like Hulk...
Wait, Come here.
You mean besides being with his friends' wives? What?
Well, see, that I'm not even
concerned. So many other things.
You see, that kind of thing I don't care about. It's like, you know, because first off, that's, look, I mean, man, that's Hollywood. That's
kind of the vibes.
I'm not going to fault anyone for their poly life. If that's what they're about, if that's where they're at, can't say I blame them. Oh. If I look like Hulk Hogan, I might be doing that too. I don't know.
You know, people,
not that I think he's that attractive of a man, quite frankly. I've always found him to be a very kind of a soft, muscly guy, you know?
Ooh.
Like, there's really ripped, muscly guys like Ferrigno and Arnold. Well, because he's a wrestler, not a bodybuilder. And it's a very different aesthetic. For those in the know, you know, which is why bodybuilding is a very specific homoerotic art. Whereas wrestling is a homoerotic art for everybody.
Soap on the ropes!
Oh my god, you people.
I just like bodybuilders, they're cool.
Alright, anyone listening to this on the podcast, you must subscribe to the YouTube channel just to watch Loth Hellfire shoot your dog dirty looks.
It's the little one. You know, it's Krampus's little fucking
the one with the Addis.
Little dogs. Little dogs are always trouble.
The little...
Yeah, rat terriers, in fact, don't ever get a rat terrier, bro. They're very naughty.
It's
dogs.
The like, little
he's
one
very
with
well
the...
behaved, but like, I don't know what he wants right now.
And it's the little one with the attitude. That's like your profile on our website.
Hey. You're scratching an itch. No worries.
No.
I know it's okay.
I know I'm number
not
one.
Not to be confused fire. With Marnow.
But yeah, so that's what's.
I'm kind of bummed that they're not green lighting the new Wonder Woman based on Flora.
Oh, yeah. I think it was going to be.
They're ruining the Wonder Woman property, and I literally don't know why. Every chance they've had, they've given us garbage. Here, I said it.
Well, I mean,
I said it.
Would you rather they put garbage on, a garbage show on, or not do it at all?
It wasn't going to be a garbage show, though. It's animated. The animated series are, like, great. Like, I think the outline's still floating around on online, and it seemed like a good idea. They need Wonder Woman something, okay? Wonder Woman something.
So what do you think killed that one? Is it just that, you know, she's like a product?
Because Wonder Woman movie did so bad.
Oh, I was going to say, don't think.
Probably,
that's
yeah.
That's exactly what happened.
That
and I don't think Future State's doing that well either.
Yeah,
it was based
State's
on Future
not
State.
Doing well
yeah. It's like, you know.
So it's, yeah.
It's like.
Because I was going to say, maybe the Future State Wonder Woman book's not
selling. Okay, but. So there's this pilot. I'm pretty sure you can probably see. Well, not even a pilot. I think it's like the first three episodes or something like that. You dig around. It's called Amazon, and it's like kind of like Smallville, but for Wonder Woman. And they didn't greenlight it in favor of, you know, the Berlantiverse, and I'm still hashtag bitter. It's really good. And just for whatever reason, they just don't want Wonder Woman to succeed as a property, and it just has been really bothering me for like about the last 6 years.
Yeah, I mean, I think...
At every turn, they could have had certain other people of it. No shade to Patty. She did okay with what she was forced to do. But there were other people itching and chomping at the bit that had a little more prestige. And they ended up with New Gods. There, I said it. If you know who's directing New Gods, who should have been directing Wonder Woman.
That's all I was about to say. I thought you said that, but yes, yep.
So, yeah. It's just things. Things like that. Decisions like that just make me worry. I will buy Wonder Woman. I will sell my stocks. I will sell my house. I will buy the Wonder Woman property from you, Warner Media. Just give me a call.
Just give us the whole thing. Just give us the whole thing.
I'm done with you ruining Wonder Woman.
Warners, just give us the whole thing.
Yeah, well, they're not going to give it to anyone because it has value. Cause,
it has value, but they're ruining it vastly.
Well, you know what their problem is? Is they want to make... I mean, this sounds kind of silly, but they... Their attempts to make new content doesn't translate well the ideals of the iconography.
Exactly.
So
you
it's
see
like
that most with Superman for sure.
Yeah, Wonder Woman, Superman are very iconic images, and they are, and you don't need to do much to translate them. You know, that's why, you know, Christopher. Yeah, I was watching a Caravan of Garbage recently, and they were talking about. The Donner Superman, and how it was a adaptation of Golden Age Superman comics by guys who never worked on comics, but just vaguely remembered what Golden Age comic books were like. And that is a perfect translation of it, and it makes sense, but it actually worked, you know? It actually worked because it just embraced who it was and who it was as an image. And it was a very oversimplified image, but, you know, comics don't have to be that complex unless you're ready for them to be. And I think that's the problem that they sometimes have over at DC, which is that, you know, and I always say this, because they have Batman, and Batman translates so well. I mean, even, you know, because Batman translates as camp, because, let's face it, he's a guy dressed like a bat.
Batman.
You know?
I mean, he's based in pulp, so.
Yeah, he is a pulp character who pulps up the place, and you can make him gritty, you can make him silly. He works no matter what you do to him. Batman is like silly putty. He is just a reproduction of the comics, and it's whatever you want to reproduce him as, and he works.
Basically, he's pretty much one of the most popular, you know, comic book characters in history. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he has no power, so you can basically put him in any setting.
Exactly. But he has no power, but he has tech, so you can have Batman in space.
Yeah.
You can put Batman in space, as they did all the time in the Super Friends.
I mean, he makes the Super Friends ride in his plane, and most of them can fly.
Exactly. Well, you know, it's a long
trip.
It's
for resting. It's tactical purposes. But
for
they don't play 4D chess, I guess they can't understand.
What the heck?
Hey, even Superman had the Superman mobile. The little punchy fists. We loved that.
That's because there was kryptonite every other episode. Come on.
Well, you know, it's a real problem for the guy, you know? Lex Luthor had given him that kryptonite immunity formula, but he had to blow those chemicals through Lex's hair on purpose. On purpose.
I heard something, I think this week, on some podcast or something, they were saying, like, you know, it's not just the radiation of kryptonite. It's like, think about it. It's like, basically, you know, that's like the life force of a couple billion dead Kryptonians in each piece of kryptonite, too.
Yeah, well, I think it's mostly psychological.
Well, yeah, psychosomatic, too.
Because you realize that it's like, he never actually dies from kryptonite. It just weakens him, because I think it just makes him feel alone. It's actually the crippling ennui. That's the real death of kryptonite. It's like, my home world, I am the last, except for all those other people, but I am the last full-sized Kryptonian, except for my cousin. But she's my Aunt Dear. Come on. You know, but that's what that it's just that kryptonic ennui. And it's like, oh, I am weak. I am nothing.
That's hilarious. So, yeah. Is WandaVision still a thing right now? I don't know.
Yeah. Episode 6 dropped today. Yeah, I didn't know
how many episodes are they going? Like 8?
9.
No one knows.
Today was 6, and there's 9 in total, Lilith.
Which, as Philip pointed out, means this episode was the 90s.
Yes.
Means next episode is the 2000s, then 2010, and finally, the present day.
What are even sitcoms? What sitcoms are out in present day?
I'm sorry?
Are there any iconic ones that came out between the last 5 years that are still on the air?
Oh, well, I mean, by 2020, they don't have to. They just come into reality. So it doesn't have to.
You know it'll be.
They just have to do, so 2000s.
Oh, no, Big Bang Theory will probably be the 2010s.
Well, the penultimate episode will be the 2010. So yeah, the last episode will probably be like the present. So it'll probably be some streaming show or something.
Yeah, we know there's a Modern Family thing in 2010. Or like, I think the next one, I mean, I would rather it was Friends.
ABC, that makes sense.
I would rather it was Friends because...
That's more the 2000s, though. Late 90s.
Yeah, exactly. Well, next one is the 2000s. So the next episode, I would like it to be like Friends or it could be Mad About You.
How I Met Your Mother, damn it. Mad About You is too old. That's more mid-90s.
Ooh. Okay. Well, I don't know when things came out.
I do.
Call of Blood.
Paul Reiser fan and Helen Hunt. So.
Huge.
And they're very good.
When he's not doing voices on The Simpsons. So.
I know. That one actually had a great cast. And Helen Hunt and Hank Azaria found love for a little bit there. And then they found Godzilla, and I think they broke up shortly thereafter.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was going to bring up WandaVision here because I didn't think you were up to date, Lil.
I'm not, but I don't care about spoilers because I don't care about that show.
So. Yeah, well, also I need something to talk about in Super Connectivity.
But, oh, you know what show we can't? I mean, Lil, did you watch Black Lightning on Monday?
I did.
I mean,
it's the last season and it shows.
I mean, I kind of like where they were going with it, but it's like every season it's the same villains. It's Tobias Whale. It's...
But do we complain about that on The Flash? I mean,
No. It's not. Even Eobard.
And Wells always comes back.
Even Eobard is not there every episode. Tobias Whale is there every episode.
Okay.
He's good at his job. That's why no one cares. Black Lightning is incompetent. There I said it.
Well, okay? No, maybe he just has very competent villains. Okay, look, here's the thing.
Lala's competent?
Maybe
nobody's competent on that show.
Maybe villains.
His wife is competent.
Maybe villains and heroes should be locked in the struggle over multiple episodes.
That just reminds me of an 80s cartoon, you know, He-Man, Skeletor, Optimus Prime.
Yeah, and that was awesome. So what are you complaining about?
Yeah, but doesn't your hero...
That's just not what kids want these days, and a ratings show. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, well, that's impossible.
It's not even the whole, you know... Black Lives
you know,
Matter,
I give you a monster of the week. Everyone says it's a monster of the week. You have one overarching story with a single villain, and it's oh, why aren't there more villains on this? Because we don't want to be a monster of the week show.
But with superhero shows, it's just kind of expected. Like you just can't buck the trends, especially if you're on the CW. You gotta go with the flow.
Well, how many villains are in Black Lightning's Rogue Gallery? I guess is the question that you have to have.
They didn't have to stick to the book, though. Is the point?
Well,
like,
yeah.
Nobody knows Black Lightning like that.
But the truth of it is that you have that problem when you have. See, this is.
I mean, just do what Arrow did: steal a bunch of Batman villains.
Well, that's
the
thing.
Technically, he was a part of the Outsiders, so at least that would actually make sense.
Exactly.
But only if Berlanti wants him to have it. That's the problem. That's
Berlanti
like
Berlanti really is only producer in name. He has really nothing to do with the show. The show.
No. But well, then whoever is in charge. Actually, who is in charge at DC?
Maya Brockett-Hill and her husband.
Okay. Well, whoever.
Black Lightning, yeah.
So it. But it's sort of like how they would not let Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. use the word sword.
Yeah, because
even
they knew supposedly they said they wanted sword for the movies and or now WandaVision.
No, they wanted Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. to not have sword.
Yeah, no, because they were saving it for the movies.
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. was always
on
his own little corner.
Well, yeah, but the idea is
time to promote the movies. Yeah, no.
Where they were was they wanted them in their. They wanted them in a corner. And that's basically what Black Lightning is. They're like, yeah, they could give Black Lightning a lot of villains, but you know what? We want to save that villain for later.
Well, it's hurt the show, and every single season, they have their ratings by half. Literally by half every single season.
But you know what the sad thing is? Is they don't have to play like that. They could do what Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. said. And they said, okay, give us your most obscure villain. What obscure character could we have? You know, you can have Angar the Screamer. Okay, we're gonna do an episode with Angar the Screamer, and we're gonna make it work, and we're gonna come up with our own villains, and we're gonna do our own thing. Because F you don't want to give us what we want. We're gonna make it happen.
It's just the showrunner being weird. She is known, and I hate saying difficult, but it is known she is difficult to work with.
I mean, after Crisis, he's on the same earth as the rest of those shows.
People
forgot,
it seems like. I don't know.
Bring in a Flash villain. Bring in, you know, Arrow's not on the air anymore. Bring in some Arrow villain. Something.
You know, so...
Nobody wanted to go down and play in Atlanta. They can't now, period.
True.
Way in Atlanta.
I keep forgetting. Yeah, they film in Atlanta.
He could have mixed with Stargirl because she's there, but...
You know. Well, yeah, we don't know if Stargirl's in
this.
She
is on this earth.
She is.
No, she's Earth 2, right?
Earth 2.
Just wait for it.
Yeah, is there still an Earth 2? I don't know.
Yeah, they made an Earth 2.
It's a new Earth 2, yeah.
Oh, they made a new Earth 2
after Crisis.
They couldn't wait.
Crisis.
That's like the real Crisis. Okay. They couldn't wait.
Well, you know, because we knew that they were going to do that. It's sort of like, and you know, to be fair, there's always that one universe that escapes the whole cosmic Armageddon. It's like the MC2. If you look read between the lines, never got
down the barrier.
The MC2 did not get destroyed when they did the big incursion storyline across all of Marvel. The MC2 was the one universe that actually just continued on with no incursions. Why? Because. And
just
F your
case.
Feelings. You know, that's the thing. It's like you can. These universes, they can do whatever they want. And that's the thing. I actually think that's a lazy writing thing if you're not going to come up with a new challenge because someone says you can't use this character, you can't do this thing.
I don't know what's going on at that show, but ever since season 2, it's been no bueno. Mm-hmm. It's just been kind of on a downhill slope. And then well, all the things that people are saying behind the scenes, like that one girl kind of wants to leave.
Who wants to leave?
China. McClane.
I mean,
so it's like a whole thing over there.
What's the last season anyway?
Not to be rude, but man, it's
it's the CW, so.
Yeah, but I mean, like, if you look at Warner's media as a whole, and you look at the idea that, as you've suggested, that they keep on hurting Wonder Woman for some reason, are they hurting Black Lightning for a similar reason?
I don't think so. They want a black character better than Cyborg so bad, it's not even funny. They hate Cyborg. even before Ray Fisher got cast, they did not want to do the Cyborg thing. I don't know why they did. I guess because they couldn't do the Green Lantern thing, so they felt like they had to have it. You know, I'm like, there's other black heroes in DC.
But are there? I don't know. Okay. I mean, I will defer. I don't read DC, so I don't know. I know that, like...
Exactly. There are. Okay. It doesn't have to be this way. It's my point.
do they have a Bill Foster they can pull out when they need it? Do they have that backbench of African-American superheroes from the 70s?
I mean, they actually do. They just don't.
Well, why don't they?
Well, I think the new Batman.
They're lazy.
That's literally what they're there for. It's like, you know, but this is the thing. DC always wants to be, we just want to deal with the top tier characters.
Well, they tried Vixen, and then they had a scuffle with the actress. If you know, you know.
Then you recast the actress. Do they think anybody cares who the actor or actress is?
Well, she had a pretty good following. She was dating Chris Rock at the time, so... Yeah.
You know what? Just hire someone better. That's how that works,
it's
see.
It's the CW. You can't.
Are you talking about original one?
Original. Yeah, original okay. Vixen.
I mean, just why
she
didn't.
She was supposed to have her own live-action show. She's supposed to be on Legends, and then they did the whole weird... just saying, just like Kid Flash. God bless
her. And then they did recast her on Legends, and it was great. So, you know what? Maybe you shouldn't be so afraid to recast. I liked that vision. You know, that's my thing. And that's the thing, is Legends, when they don't have a character, they just create one. It's like, we'll say there's a leprechaun shapeshifter character now. That works, yeah. Why not? What the heck?
We need to make this actor somebody else. Okay, let's do it.
Yeah, it worked.
But okay.
It works as a story, man.
I don't know what's going on in DC. Somebody needs to, whip them into shape. I can't take it anymore.
All I ever say is that, you know...
I don't know what's going on.
DC never had to struggle like Marvel did in the media, and so they never...
We've never been bankrupt, that's true.
Never had to grow as a... Well, you know, it's like... You think about the 80s Incredible Hulk. You think about how that little show that was like everything else that just did not have anything from Marvel, had what it had, and that was all it wanted, and it was going to do it, and it did it well. And they built their little human stories. It's like I always say, you know, the reason why your creative writing teacher says, I don't want you writing sci-fi, I don't want you writing ghost stories, I don't want you writing any of these things, is because you have to write a human story first. You can't just rely on fan service and, ooh, I know who that Easter egg is. You can't rely on that as a writer. You have to be able to write a good story first. And if you write a good story first, then you can put in the Easter eggs for fun and it's enjoyable. And that's essentially what I feel about things like, you know, what WandaVision is, what I'm hoping Winter Soldier will be. And, Captain America and Bucky will be. Is that it's going to be a good story about people working together and solving their problems. Oh, and then, yeah, there's going to be some people in costumes and they're going to shoot some laser guns every so often. But, and that's fun, too. By the way, are we going to talk about the Falcon Winter Soldier?
Oh, the trailer from the Super Bowl. Yeah.
I don't think we've talked about that yet because there's a psychiatrist in the room who is clearly manipulating these two heroes to be at each other's throats. That's Carla Soffin. Mark my words.
I don't know. Wasn't she older? You know, they want a young, pretty blonde, you know, who they can keep in the room for 10 years.
That's how they get you. In the same way they made, how in Jessica Jones they had the ringmaster, but they changed who he was a bit too. Look, made him into the hypnotherapist, but you knew that man was going to turn evil if they had another season.
Look, you're physically hurting a little
help. Well, obviously he was a hypnotist.
Hey-oh.
No offense.
Mm-hmm. You're hurting a little fire from this Falcon Winter Soldier talk.
I'm just saying, I mean, maybe there's another evil, manipulative psychiatrist out there. And for all we know, maybe they give her the Moonstone and she, like, takes off her glasses and shakes out her hair. And then... Because not for nothing, it's way easier to make someone look less attractive than more attractive. So if you get an actually kind of hot actress and put her in frumpy clothes and the glasses, and then, you know, suddenly, oh, transformation. That's why that's a trope, you see.
What did you say?
I'm telling you.
Oh, my gosh, she's got a ponytail and glasses. And what is that? Paint on her overalls? Oh!
Exactly.
Lilith Hellfire always goes back to that movie. Yeah.
It's a good movie, not another
Chris
team.
Chris Evans! You know what I say about Chris Evans?
Chris Evans can do it all day, every day.
Oh, heard a great theory, just a fun fan idea is, now that we have Pietro, they should have Chris Evans show up in WandaVision, and you think it's Captain America, and then he goes, flame on.
We all just want to forget about that.
That's not the big one.
No, we don't. No one wants to. You want to.
I thought you were
going to. That's the thing. It's like someone recently said, hey, at least as a society, we collectively said no to Yahoo Serious. And I said, no, you said no to Yahoo Serious. Some of us love Yahoo Serious. Ned Kelly forever. Thank you.
Oh, my God. No, even if it's just like the last 5 minutes of the episode to like punch out bad guys, you bring in Chris Evans and Renner, and you have Cap's kooky quartet.
Oh, yeah. Well, there you go.
Well, they're pushing Renner out the door, too, he's
moving into his old man stage as a superhero.
He's passing on the torch, and we'll never see Renner again.
He'll just be sitting in that apartment eating pizza, and Kate Bishop.
Yeah, well, that's what he's going to do. I'm guessing there's like, it's going to be interesting how they read it, because it's probably going to be like a kind of sad thing where it's like, yeah, me and the wife, it was hard after the snap. And this is where you're going to, again, explore that psychological damage that the snap caused. And the idea that, it was a day for them. It was 5 years for him. He went out, he went totally nuts. And then it's like, my husband was the I don't kill people husband, though I shoot bow and arrows at people. It's like, I know that's who I was. And, I've done some things I'm not proud of, but, I always did that, but I was always the nice guy. And now I was a murderer.
And Hayward told Monica this week on WandaVision, you were gone for 5 years. You don't know what it took to keep the lights on.
I don't know, he had to do a double shift? Only half the people were gone. It's not like, oh my gosh, half the people are gone. It's I worked at McDonald's. Like, man, well, call Larry. See if Larry hasn't been blipped. Get him here to work the fry later. Okay, look, I know that there's a backlog of fries, but actually, fortunately, there's only half as many of you who want fries today. So, actually, kind of works out. It's actually... fewer people buying fries, but we don't need as many people on to work the station. So I guess, I guess everything's in balance.
But yeah, we're definitely getting Young Avengers. Yeah, because Kate Bishop, we got the twins. Yeah,
and I've heard that Teddy is coming, and Teddy may be the aerospace engineer.
Oh,
we'll have to see. Well, because originally they were saying it was the girl, but it could also be the girl's brother or someone else,
or Teddy could show up in Secret Invasion.
Mm-hmm. Teddy could be anywhere. Teddy as the Kree Skrull hybrid is interesting
because they were saying
So here's a crazy thought. Teddy is the son of Captain Marvel. Do you think Carol Danvers got busy with a Skrull at some point? Had little Teddy?
She could have without her knowledge.
I mean, no. Well, why would it be without her knowledge?
Because they're shapeshifters?
No, but I mean, she knows Skrulls. She knows who they are.
Well, yeah.
I mean, I thought you were saying, like, she didn't know she was pregnant. No, we're not doing that story.
No, we're never doing that story again. No.
Nobody likes that story. That story never happened.
We erase Avengers 200 from the...
No. I'm saying, what if some... Maybe her and Talos... I don't know Skrull marriage rituals. Maybe, like, yeah, man, thruple time. You know, that could be their thing. And so maybe... Teddy will be the son of Captain Marvel and a high-ranking leader of the Skrulls. Anything's possible. Wouldn't that be fun?
And are we getting Elijah Bradley in Falcon and Winter Soldier, maybe?
I mean, anything's... I hope so.
Yeah.
Wouldn't hope so. Then you also have Elijah Bradley's son, which is another possibility where they actually... what was his... Isaiah X, I think he goes by the name of...
Oh.
Or is it Isaiah or Josiah? I forget. But Isaiah Bradley is actually... because you have the original Captain America, then you have the younger character. I believe he went by the name Patriot, correct? Or... I'm so down on my Young Avengers trivia. Yeah, but anyway...
But yeah, I thought...
Anyway, I'm trying to remember who the actual original Black Captain America was. Was it Isaac or was it Isaiah?
Isaiah.
And then... So who's the one on Young Avengers?
Elijah, that's why I said...
Elijah, okay. So it's Isaiah... And who's the one who was taken with, like, stolen sperm?
Whoa, what?
And... You don't know that story? They were called The Crew was a early 2000s book. I didn't read it. I just read it. I read things in, like, you know.
Oh, are you talking about the Skrull?
The Wiki. He reads the Wiki.
The Skrull Kill Crew or whatever?
No, not the Skrull Kill Crew. There was a group of African-American superheroes or black superheroes. They were basically the government because, well, hey, we have this super soldier in prison. What if we stole some of his DNA and, you know, basically made another one because, you know, his children, you know, because he had a child before he got the super soldier serum. What if we made another and we just steal his sperm? You know, we'll knock him out. We'll take his sperm. We'll impregnate a woman and ipso facto instant Captain America.
You're not talking about Isaiah Bradley?
No, not Isaiah Bradley. Okay, Bradley got his powers when he got a blood transfusion from his grandfather.
Yeah, then...
I don't know what's going on.
Okay, no, there is another black Captain America out there, and I'm blanking on his name, but I want to say...
Yeah, the original one I'm talking about.
Josiah X. I think it's Josiah...
Isaiah Bradley was the original one before Steve Rogers. That's...
Yes.
Okay. Because I swear you're getting confused between Elijah and Isaiah.
No. There it is. Josiah X... There he is. Yeah, Josiah X. Okay. He was the. I'm getting to the Marvel Wiki on him. Josiah X. His name is Josiah El Haj Sadiq. Legally changed, former legal name unrevealed. Let's see here. Josiah X's story is the story of his father, Isaiah Bradley, an African-American soldier who was a guinea pig in secret, illegal, and immoral U.S. experiments to recreate the super soldier process, which created Captain America. Isaiah and Faith Bradley's second child, the boy who would one day grow into the man called Josiah X, was not actually born to the couple. When Josiah came into this world, it was by way of artificial insemination using Josiah's inactive sperm following the effects of the super soldier serum, and a healthy sample from before the serum was administered. Like her husband before her, Faith's body was violated by men in the U.S. military involved in dark events that took place at Camp Cathcart. dun dun dun. Yeah, so it's a pretty messed up story. Look it up though, kids. That's Marvel history.
I thought we were done talking about Whedon.
Yeah. No, yeah, so Josiah X is the other Black Captain America that maybe I guess we don't talk about much anymore.
Okay, I know. But, I don't that does not sound familiar to me. I don't.
Yeah, it was yeah, cuz it was really controversial and made people feel bad. It's like, "Oh, the government's evil." I don't like that story, duh. But now people say, "Oh yeah, the government's evil. Let's make sure Joss Whedon never works again." Because now people are sick of it. We used to be afraid to face it. Now we're finally facing it. That's a good thing. It's a good thing that we're so angry today. At least that's my opinion. What's yours? Anyone want to talk comic books?
Yes.
Yeah, let's talk comics.
Let's talk Riverdale, Southside Serpents, number one.
Corner.
Oh, my.
How did you like it, Charlie?
I love this book, man. I want Southside Serpents number two, man. Where is that book?
It'll be a minute.
It does a two-year freaking jump at the end? And it's like, oh, we find Jughead's real name is Faldsworth or Feldspar or something. I don't know. It's something or other.
We've always known Jughead's real name.
Forsyth. I didn't. Well, maybe you did. You know, maybe.
I mean, they've said it a few times in the comic books. I mean, a lot of times in the comic books.
I'm sure they have, Lilith. This may come as a shock to you, Lilith.
They even said it on the Archie cartoons that I thought you watched. Or you just watched the Ghoulies. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I watched Sabrina and the Groovy Ghoulies. I didn't really watch the Archies. I think the Archies were technically actually a little before my time. They weren't. We knew they existed. They were an iconic band. After all, we all sang Sugar Sugar. But no, I didn't really watch that much of the Archies. It was. I think there was actually rights disputes. I think you could get that the syndication on Sabrina was easier. I think Archie Comics.
Yeah,
kind
that's
of,
very true. That's why she got a TV show first.
Yeah, I think that Archie really was being very protective of their intellectual product. Intellectual property. But no, man, this is a great story about basically, and honestly, I love this.
Especially if you don't watch Riverdale, you don't know that side that they're getting at about Jughead. It's like a, wait, what?
Well, no, but that's the thing. It's like, even within that, like, what I'm going to say is this is a good story. This doesn't have to be about Jughead. It's about you know, Prince Ferday. It's about the kid who is the son of a gang leader, and then also this weird kind of quasi-interesting and honestly not for nothing throwback to me kind of view. I mean, when they bust up the Nazi rally, it so reminded me of the freaking Blues Brothers saying, "I hate Chicago Nazis," and just running the car through it, and that it's such a beautiful cathartic moment in the Blues Brothers. You know, and I abhor violence, but dang, it feels good in a completely ridiculous film like the Blues Brothers, and it feels good when Jughead does it. So I don't want to give away this book. Everyone should go out buy Riverdale, Southside Serpents number one. Make them make issue two. It's worth.
They've already made it, but yeah. It's just going to be a while because of how Archie's cycle is right now with the economy and things like that.
Okay, I don't know, man. I really want to see what happens in those 2 years. I really want to see Jughead's growth in this situation. You know, like I said, it's not the Jughead I grew up with, but I actually can understand. It's like when you watch The Incredible Hulk from the 70s. It's not David. It's not Bruce Banner. It's not Gamma Bombs. It's not all that stuff. But you know the spirit in it. Either there is an honor to the spirit, and then there is a greater story to be told. That's what Marvel unlocks in their stories that DC cannot happen to. I think Archie may have done it well here, too. And I guess given the success of Riverdale, I guess they probably have. So, bully for Archie.
It's not the Archie I'm used to, but I don't mind it. It's just, you know, it's all timeline Jughead, you know. I figure he just got stuck when he was doing the time travel police thing, and that's
yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, that's the thing. Is like if you like the larger Archie, I can see how this would be a real sharp turn, which is why a lot of people said, "What are you doing?" But to me, I can
Jughead and Riverdale. I do.
Yeah, I can get down with a real world Archie. It's like this may get me into Riverdale. Except I hear it's too soap opera-y, and it's like very...
If you can watch wrestling, you can watch Riverdale.
Well, I don't watch wrestling. I just like wrestling. There's a difference between liking something and watching it.
A sexually adventurous freak.
You know,
I don't know what that means. I'm a millennial. I don't know what that means.
Okay, let's see.
We change everything, even if we hate it.
This was all years ago.
Yeah, years ago. See, back in the day, we couldn't binge things. Things were just given to us when they wanted to give it to us. And we would enjoy them, and we'd get the stories, we'd pick it up. But it never required a major commitment in our lives.
I know and the language the kids use these days.
I do. I'm hip to the jive, Turkey.
That book too, though. That's, for me, that's what, like, the Riverdale books, they really give it. They take it away from that classic Archie look, and they just give it something more modern and stylized that I think they do a really great job with.
Yeah, I really like it. I like his whole reference to the Ouroboros. There's just so many good things in this. The only thing that really takes me out of it a little bit is when they go to the biker rally, and they basically just go to, like, a mini Burning Man, and that was, like... That's just Burning Man. Why are you guys going to Burning Man?
You know.
I mean, they even have like a Thunderdome for no reason.
Weed, you know.
That's like, if you've ever been to Burning Man, you know about the Thunderdome. And it's kind of cool that they have one there, but it's like they never
Burning Man's more like ate some mushrooms, but yeah.
Smoked a doobie.
Yeah, it's a fun place to do mushrooms. Just stay where the lights are. Stay around the lights.
Exactly.
You know, don't go look at the stars and try to walk to them. But, you know, honestly, that's the thing. Mushrooms don't really send you that nuts. That's the good thing about mushrooms. It's a very mellow thing. And you can walk.
Allegedly, it's a medical term. I don't know what's going on.
Well, I don't know. I'm going to tell you. It's actually, yeah. I mean, even when you're tripping hard, it's still like everything's there. It's like you can still see reality, or maybe just my mind is so superior that I just control myself to the level where
maybe
it's like,
you just have a high tolerance.
That could be it too. I am very fat, and the brain is fat, so anything that affects the brain has to work really hard to get there. It's like, no, there's fat right there. Can't we just make that fat truck? It's like, no, we're supposed to go to the special fat at the top. It's like, I don't want to. I just want to make this part drunk. It's like, oh, why does my belly tingle?
Hey, do you watch Adventure Time, Charlie?
Adventure Time? I have. I mean, I don't follow it. It's.
Oh.
I have watched it. I've always liked it.
Adventure Time people.
You know, basically, here's my thing. It's like... And again, this goes to the way I digest things as a nerd. It's like, I know a lot about Adventure Time because I watch all the videos. I watch all the people dissecting and telling me about it. It's like, oh, good. I'm a student of Adventure Time. I don't actually watch Adventure Time. I'm more interested in the lore than the adventure. I'm that kind of freak.
Well, on that note then, Christine Larson, who, you know, if you know Adventure Time, you know her. She has a book out, and it's called Orcs Number One. Ooh. And it's cute. It's like, you know, it's kind of very animal theme-ish. They're like pandas, raccoons, things of that nature. But they're orcs, you know, gladiators and all that stuff.
Wait. I'm sorry. You got to walk me through this, because I'm fascinated already, and I really want to know more about this. So
we're doing me now.
It's called Orcs.
Yes, but the actual animals that are the orcs in the book are like raccoons and pandas and things like that. It's kind of very in the vein of Adventure Time kind of artwork, but like more, what's the word I'm looking for? More furry. If you were into furries in Adventure Time, just picture that. But the story is great. It's fun.
I can work with that. I'm intrigued.
I think it's a really cute book. It's an all ages book, I'm pretty sure. Cartoon violence, but it's really funny.
As luck would have it, I'm all ages
because of an acorn prank. Like,
so is this a comic book or is this
book.
Oh, it's like a floppy, like a $3.99 floppy, not like an
$4.99 floppy, but yeah. Oh. I want to say it's Boom or is it IDW? Let me double check. It is Boom.
I'm going to keep an eye out for Orcs. I'm going to see if
Orcs
I can find
one.
It.
Orcs number one. Christine Larson, she did the story and she did the art. And like I said, if you're an Adventure Time fan, you probably want to jump on this if you haven't heard about it yet.
Very cool. Phil, what is your all ages book? Well, actually, Serpents is not all ages. But
no, no, sir.
No, I was going to say, of course, I have all Marvel, DC, except, I mean, the only other book I got, of course, we talked last week, Radiant Black number one.
Yes.
Ooh, Radiant Black number one. Well, we already talked about that. Yes. So.
I picked up
go to the show notes. It's a good book.
All right. I will say I started reading something on DC Universe Infinite. I mean, I'm like a year behind the game here, but I mean, I'm pretty much caught up. I still got to get an issue or two in between, but I'm current now on Green Lantern Far Sector, which is a really good book.
Ooh, huh, yes.
I wonder why you're all getting all caught up on Green Lantern. I wonder.
I don't know, Lilith.
I think because we have a podcast about it from the boys that brought you the Quantum Zone.
In brightest day.
In blackest.
Yeah, you know.
Just going to cut off your part? How noble.
They can only cut off my
no
part.
People will escape our sight.
That's right. So, but I mean, no, it's a really good story. I mean, even getting into some real world things with, you know, should people be allowed to peacefully protest? And, you know,
not if Sinestro has his way.
Yeah, well, that's because he's Sinestro. He's the bad guy. His name is Sinestro,
and he's not.
He has a couple of good points. That's all I'm gonna say.
And he's not in this story. So.
Look, I'm just saying, you know. As I've always said, man, the Guardians knew. They knew. They're like, oh, yeah, I guess it's bad that we have a fascist Green Lantern. I guess we should strip him of his powers then. You know, which just caused more problems, really. They could have just said, look, you know, he raises some valid points, Sinestro. Maybe we should all sit down. And Hal, you tell us why fascism is bad. We're going to discuss this. And we'll see how fascism in a completely unregulated galactic police force that no one invites to their planet actually works within this fascism bad idea. So,
yeah. I mean, again, it's like a very far off sector, but it's a human Green Lantern. Her name was Joe Mullen or something. Yeah, really good story. And I guess they're going to be folding her into like, I guess whatever's coming after Future State, because at the end of Future State 2, it's like, you know, most of the Green Lanterns had lost their ring power, and then but finally how Jordan gets to Oa, and this new Lantern's like, what did you do? Why weren't you here to help everybody? And it's just like, it's Hal Jordan. What do you expect from Hal Jordan?
Has Hal Jordan ever helped anyone?
With his power ring.
You need that guy who draws the pictures to come. He's the guy that rebuilds stuff.
You shut your filthy mouth.
Kyle Rayner, yes!
Yes, Kyle Rayner. No, suck I know it, that. You know, look, I love Jon Stewart as much as the next guy. I really think they should have started with Jon Stewart.
I love to hate Hal. I'm not gonna lie.
Suck it, Miller.
But Parallax is the best version of him, and you can fight me.
Anyway, oh boy, yeah.
Anything new from DC, Philip?
I did get some Future State books, Lil, because that, you know, besides,
here we are in the future, and it's swell!
I mean,
bought me Love is a Battlefield. I haven't read it, but it's here.
Oh my. But no, I mean, this week the only thing that was new that wasn't Future State was, Green Lantern Season 2, number 11.
I saw that.
Yeah.
Wait, why is it Season 2?
Because Grant Morrison did 12 issues, and now he's doing another 12.
But, like, they did the season.
We already talked about this, Charlie.
We did the seasons because it was, oh, you know that TV show you like that had seasons? Well, there's a comic book that's like, this is what would have happened in the next season.
Because it's Grant Morrison, and he gets very high on anything he can.
But it's not a season.
That's what he wants.
And he sells books. Yes, that's it. Yeah, that's what he wanted.
Okay, if he's selling the books, hey, who am I to argue? You know, if it sells, it sells.
He smokes that jazz lettuce. Okay,
smoke the doobie.
The devil's lettuce. Get it right.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, well, you know, everyone likes lettuce. Hail that's Satan. All I know.
Hail Satan.
Nice that was a light week for me, to be honest. So.
Yeah, it was for me too. Although that's
I do want to shout out Red Sonja Superpowers number 2. I'm not done with it. I'm halfway through, but that artwork is stunning.
Red Sonja Superpowers?
Mm-hmm.
So like Red Sonja, like Jane Bikini?
And then like colon Superpowers. So it's like I can't explain it. Hold on. Maybe I should try to explain.
Wait, too long to explain. Let me sum up.
What is it?
No, it's just basically she's getting into a lot of lesbian cat fights, shall we say, with other superpowered people, and the artwork is chef's kiss. It's just basically a punch him up with a bikini. Like, you don't really have to think okay. about it. It's just something.
But Red Sonja doesn't have superpowers.
This one she does. So they're just trying different things with Red Sonja to see what sticks. You know, that they've just kind of been going through that rebuilding phase with Red Sonja. I don't know if you've noticed.
Yeah.
They did it with Barbarella and a couple other people.
Yeah, that's like when someone said, hey, what if we gave, the Shadow a mech suit? I don't know. I don't...
They're just trying different things to see what sticks because, you know, she's always kind of in danger of... Just because her whole world's been chopped off at the knees, if you know what I mean. So, like,
You
can't do a lot of exploring, so we have to do a lot of OC stuff, you know, original
characters. Although, weirdly enough, that's the thing. So, because I get the feeling that the Howard stuff is actually now public domain because it's old enough. I think it's like one of those weird things that which is, I think, why Marvel has Conan back.
Well, they haven't really been delving into it, so if it is public domain, they better jump on it because they're really losing the plot over there. But this one,
see, the thing with Red Sonja is she actually technically isn't part of that group because she was a separate character created.
Yeah,
you know, so it's like one of those weird things where it's like technically she.
It's just the last 3 years, something weird has really happened where they kind of have stopped developing that ongoing story that they had, and they've been just trying new stuff to see what sticks.
Yeah.
And this is just a gimmick, but I love, like I said, I love the artwork. It's very nice. So, that's really all I read Red Sonja for. I'm not going to lie to you.
Yeah. And to be fair, they did the same thing with the Punisher. You know, you had to go through the Frankencastle phase and the Avenging Angel phase. And then
it's good and fun, for sure. It's entertaining, but I just kind of miss the lore and the world building that we used to have. And I just hope they get back around to it soon. But until then, I'm more than happy to just ogle at the artwork.
Oh, there you go. Well, you know, if you like the art and you like, you know, women in chainmail bikinis, which is, I understand, a lot of people do.
Beating up people. I mean, I love a punch-em-up book, and I like that it's a woman doing the punch-em-up. So, yeah.
It's always nice when people punch.
People I get it, of course. I get it.
How long do you want us to go, Phil?
All right. Yeah, well, I was going to say, did everybody read Daredevil?
Yes, I did.
2-7.
That was the extra book I read because Lilith said we would be a little bit later, and I read that book, and then I had to. And then suddenly she was early and said, oh, now I have to groom. I have to be beautiful for my public. And so, I did read it. I got things and words to say.
Of course.
You want to save it for Super?
Did you not read it?
Well, here's what I'm going to say. I'm going to say,
stay tuned.
Tying into another book I read that we'll talk about over on Super, if Mac Murdock is resistant, certain other people are resistant too. And I am sorry, Matt Murdock, and your little Catholic boy guilt. You got nothing. You got nothing on certain other people in this universe. So, but all that said, it's a delightful book. It is a delightful book. The back and forth between Matt and Null, the interpersonal relationship, and just Null being completely... And this is the thing. This is kind of that thing that I kind of feel always happens to the aliens that invade Earth. It's like, dude, you do not understand our level of mental illness. It's like the whole Typhoid Mary thing. And she's like, I guess I'll cooperate. And you're just thinking, no, you don't understand. She ain't locked in with you. You're locked in with her. It is just, I guarantee you Typhoid Mary is just going to just completely have fun in the Nullaverse and just really be the thing that breaks it up, man. I said too much, Phil?
No,
I don't know.
No, I was going to say, I just think that symbiote was just like, Matt Murdock's too much of a sad sack. I'm out of here.
No, because Null was physically there. Null was there.
Yeah.
Symbiotes don't have, like, free will, unless you happen to be the Venom symbiote. And even then, that gets overridden because Null is basically Emperor Doom. which is like a little petty schmuck who somehow wandered into enough power to hold everybody hostage. And then as soon as people like, as soon as anyone can like break free, suddenly it just starts the domino effect. And it's like, you know what? I think I'm going to break the crystal that holds the purple man. That's the whole reason why you have any power at all, you fellow. And just, you know, take it all away from him. Marvel is filled with petty dictators whose power is based on lies.
Like this is a recurring,
like real life, yes. But you know what? Like I said, I think the world's getting tired of petty dictators whose power are filled on lies.
I get so much right.
To tie it all back to the start of this episode.
Shade! Shade!
And you will find out I am right so much more often than I'm wrong.
First off, Rob.
Oh, Rob is a saint.
And Rob, I will not go that far. But you know what? Here's what I'll tell you. I don't know Rob's personal opinions on a lot of things.
Why did your eye?
And that's why I love him. That's why I love him. Because you know what? I don't need to know Rob. Just keep on making good podcast content, and no one cares. That's what it says, Charlie. And Rob is always very, very polite.
You're weak sauce.
Because that's what you need to be. Is be
boy,
polite.
We have some drops for you.
Mark my words.
So yeah, no, I'm kind of getting worried about comic books, but we'll talk about that next week.
Oh. Yeah. Okay.
The direct market specifically. Yeah,
yeah.
I'm very worried.
Okay. Well, you know, I mean, how much do comic books cost to make? That's the thing. It's like...
It's not about that specifically. It's just the industry as a whole.
Decision making.
And the creeples that reside there within. If Joss Whedon is getting kicked out, boy, do I have news for a lot of y'all faves.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, no, because there are enough people that... That's the thing. That's the, like a Joss Whedon where they stick their fingers in. Oh, no, I'm sure there's lots of jerks in the business. Honestly, if I had gained fame in my youth, I'd probably be much more of a jerk than I am now.
Before the internet? Before the...
Well, hey, you know, it doesn't matter if you were a jerk before the internet. People will still remember what you said that one time. You know, I mean, that's the thing.
Sweet
it's like
boy, didn't happen. That
you can be serious without your pants on.
Hey, you know what? Bill Cosby never tweeted about none of that stuff. It all came back in the end.
I recognize. So you know,
that's the thing.
Again,
it's like
I said, you can only you piss off the wrong people. All your skeletons come out of the closet.
I don't mind me. I don't pay attention.
Well, Hollywood conspiracies. Just wait for it, Patreon.
I was going to say, are you ready to?
No,
name,
you know.
Are you ready to name names next week, Little Hellfire?
Not next week, but soon.
Okay.
I just want to take this moment now to say, Lilith, if I ever have offended you because I was drunk at the time, I just want to say, you know what? I hope we can still be friends. I do apologize for anything that happened. Anytime I made anyone feel, and fail you to, if I ever make you feel uncomfortable... In my room, so that's fine.
I am sorry, Lilith Hellfire. If I
everybody
ever,
froze.
If I Lilith, I'm sorry if I ever offended you because you didn't get my great ideas.
Okay.
Smoking like a tree.
I think I froze out at the moment. I was trying to do the same thing for Phil there and just say, you know, Phil, if I ever I do want to make. I just want to get ahead of this. I want to get ahead of this. I want to say,
that's a good PR look, stunt. I just want to get ahead of this.
You know, hey, here's the thing. I'm no angel. You know, I grew up in a different era. I'm so old, after all, as I say. And, you know, there was a time.
I was sitting here, he pointed that camera at his crotch.
I'm just saying, there's a reason why I drifted
bills.
Over
get
this
out
box.
Of here,
I know.
Okay, yes.
Lilith was like, this is getting too serious.
Well, you know, yeah, I can't hear you guys very well. You know, I think I should upgrade my headphones.
I think you should.
How
could I do that, Philip?
I think you should. Always thrown off my rhythm. Yes, you should go get yourself some tweaked audio headphones.
For that crystal clear HD quality audio.
That's right. Tweakedaudio.com. You can use the code Southgate, that's right, for a handy discount on those.
Mark my words.
And when you're tired of canceling people, maybe Hunter Killer with Michelle Gay.
That's right.
I have segues too, Philip. Thank you.
Nice. Yes, and you can also use the code Southgate for that for a handy discount.
So I'm not interested in any of that. I want to just buy what I want to buy. How can I do that?
Are you a reader, Charlie Esser? Because you can pick up Podlife the book. No.
Where can I ever pick up a book called Podlife the book? That sounds ridiculous. I don't think that exists.
Well, you can go to Amazon, but the way to get there is to use the link below in the show notes. Because not only will it help our show and our podcast network, but it'll also keep pants on that madman.
Petty dictator.
Rob El Presidente, Rob Master Doom Southgate.
Make it rain, so says Master
Doom. You mean no matter what I buy on Amazon, it helps the show?
That's right,
Charlie.
No matter what
you buy, no matter what shows up discreetly packaged.
That Swedish penis pump. All right, so
those don't actually work.
The hard was in.
Okay. But yes, but if you want to send your thoughts on anything we talked about, any comic book, TV shows, movies, email us capesandlunatics@gmail.com or call the voicemail 614-382-2737. That's 614-38-CAPES. And remember, you can find Capes and Lunatics all over social media, all of our various shows, links to this YouTube channel, links to the Patreon, links to merchandise. All in one place. That's Linktree, linktr.ee/capesandlunatics. All right, Lilith, where can people find you if they want to get canceled?
If you want to, don't at me, bro, but you can find me on Twitter, @LilithHellfire. Over on Instagram, being adorable with my puppies, smoothies, and cold pressed juice, @LilithHellfire86. And of course, if you're looking for the spicy memes, @LilithHellfire69 on TikTok and the gram.
Go ahead, throw it in. All y'all can just shut the hell up.
Charlie Esser.
Well, if you'd like to write to me in an old-fashioned email way the way our mothers and fathers once did, do so at superconnectivityblog@gmail.com. That's superconnectivityblog, all one word, @gmail.com. And of course, follow me on the Twitter as I live tweet Batwoman Sunday nights at 8 and DuckTales of Woohoo's Monday nights at 7 whenever they're on, and I remember to do so at CharlieEsser. Look for the two E's in the middle.
For quality.
Bing!
Thank you, Maz.
Ah, I gotcha.
That's the man.
Whichever one.
One of the Mazes.
The real Maz Manzor.
The totally real Maz Manzor.
Totally! Alright, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Come back next time. But until then, we have been your capes.
Ampersand!
Lunatics!
Wow, I was all characters.
Only 196 episodes.
Oh, that's when you sleep back to back. And head to toe.
It's coming.
We got two boob windows coming, don't worry.
Hey-o.
I could use a good boob window.
Hello. I got
somebody get that man a Gwynpool cosplay.
I wish.
Bruce Springsteen is known around the world as one of rock and roll's most dynamic performers because of his music and his live shows. He also has a passionate fan base. I'm Jesse Jackson, and for the past 4 years on Setlist and Bruce, I've talked to Springsteen fans from around the world. Each of them sharing why Bruce and his music has meant so much to them in their daily lives. If you love Bruce Springsteen's music, or if you just love good stories from passionate fans, I hope you will check out Set Lust in Bruce, the Bruce Springsteen podcast, wherever you can find your favorite podcasts. Remember, there is magic in the night.